Welcome to another Brewed Awakening. I'm Jamie Gates, Director of the Center for Justice and Reconciliation and the Brewed Awakening series to serve. Fairtrade coffee, tea, and speakers serve the social conscience. That's our purpose here tonight. The center, its mission is to study poverty and oppression and to teach Christian means of social engagement. So the speakers we bring on a regular basis bring some of the hottest contemporary social issues that are going on, and they're typically people of faith who have that part of themselves to share in this forum. So the center also has internships in a number of different areas: human trafficking, immigration, Sabbath economics, homelessness, and Christian peacemaking. And I have two of my favorite people up here to tell you a little bit about two of the different things going on with some of the other internships.
Hello, my name is Haley Swan, and I am the intern for human trafficking this semester. I lead a group called Beauty for Ashes, and we meet on Wednesday nights at 6 o'clock. And the goal of that group is to prayerfully engage with what the Lord has for us in His redemptive plan for human trafficking. We realize that human trafficking is a huge, dark issue, and it's really easy to become overwhelmed by the reality of it, and the more that you look into it, the darker it gets. But we are dedicated to the truth that the Lord is a God of redemption, and that He's bringing hope. And so you might have seen on the timeout schedule, I don't know, I'm speaking tomorrow, and what we're doing tomorrow is trying to make the issue of human trafficking more approachable in prayer, because sometimes we're called to, like, okay, like, you can pray about it, and we're told that with these huge issues like hunger and AIDS and poverty and human trafficking. And we're like, okay, like, just, like, where do I start? And so it's, the goal is to make it a little bit more approachable and to wrestle with the idea that we're called to have a heart modeled after the Lord's heart. And that includes living with Him in His joys and also in the sorrow too. So.
Tomorrow night, what time?
Tomorrow night, 9 o'clock, Round Chapel. And if you're interested in getting more information or getting coffee, I have, like, friends or just chatting about things like this, or being part of Beauty for Ashes, you can sign the clipboard and indicate that, and I'll get your information and hunt you down. Yeah. All
right. Hello, I'm David McKiffin. I'm working with different immigration topics, and really I just want to let you all know about a great activity they have coming up next Saturday and Sunday, the 26th and 27th of March. We're going to have a border tour. We like to call it a pilgrimage, as it's a time we're going to be able to discuss both with PLNU students and students from Azusa Pacific University, and different people. We're going to listen to several different speakers, border patrol, pastors, activists, all around border issues, and something that's, you know, right here, right close to us. So if you're interested, it's going to be a really good time digging into some tough stuff and also challenging ourselves spiritually, and each other spiritually. What? Oh yeah, we're going also into Mexico, so we'll need a passport and that kind of stuff. But we'll be there. We'll be going to the Casa del Migrante as well, which you'll find out about, I guess. So if you're interested, it's $30 because of the different expenses, Saturday and Sunday, and you can register online. It's limited to 20 people, 20 students from Point Loma, so register soon. And it will be this back there on the table, and you can register online. So, thanks. So, thank you both. Thank you, Haley, and David. I first heard about human trafficking probably back in 2002 from the International Justice Mission. Gary Hagen came out here and spoke at a Presbyterian church. And since then, it's been more sort of student action and student activity that has brought this concern to the table than any. Some of us teach about this a little bit in our classes and so on. It's interesting. Look across the room real quick. If you don't mind, would all the guys in the room just stand up real quick? All three of you. Okay. Yeah. So look at this. All right. I want to say something about this. And Doug was telling me here, you'll be better than this, but Doug was telling me here that, go ahead, sit down, thank you guys. The minority of people in this room are guys, right? A handful of guys compared to a room full of women when it comes to discussing human trafficking. The victims of human trafficking disproportionately are women. The perpetrators of human trafficking are disproportionately men. So we got to figure out a way to have this conversation broaden out to the men on campus. And so the missionary men that are in the room today come to hear about this stuff. You have an assignment, but so do the rest of us in this room. Figure out a way that this conversation becomes more than just a concern of those who are of the gender of the victims, right? And there's a lot of work to be done there. We've been engaged in this for quite some time. Point Loma has a website. It's actually a blog, abolishhumantrafficking.com. If you want to check it out. This is a 2009 viewpoint. You can take copies that are out there in the alumni magazine. You're students now, many of you, but you'll become alumni. We've been spreading the word about this to the alumni as well. So go ahead and take a look at what the university is doing. It's my privilege and pleasure to invite Jenna Hudlow to come tonight. I got to hear a bit of her story at lunch today, but she's going to tell you all about Tiny Hands and the work that you're doing. We're really blessed to have you, and the work you're doing around the world, in Nepal in particular. You and your husband both doing interesting research there and work. So can we give just a big hand, a big warm hand?
And I also have to just give a shout out to Lindsay Springer. Where is that girl? Is she still here? Oh, there you are. Lindsay, thank you so much. I actually met Lindsay in D.C. I live in D.C. My husband and I live there. And Lindsay came out for her internship at Flair's Project. And just as a plug, if any of you come to D.C., get my car, because I'd love to cook dinner for you. But Lindsay definitely put this together. She put all the connections together. And, you know, coming from D.C., it wouldn't have happened to come all the way to San Diego without you. So thanks so much. And she's graduating this year, so just a shout out for all the seniors for all of your hard work and putting these last minute engagements together. So I'm Jenna Hudlow, and like I said, my husband and I live in DC, and I got engaged with this work. We're both graduates of Vanguard University, and there I went to my first conference in 2006. And I was trying to put in perspective like how long ago that was and what was happening back then. It doesn't seem that long ago, but for human trafficking in Orange County, especially during lunch today, I was talking to Jamie, and I guess he really got into movement in like 2001, and that's when the first act started happening with TVPA, which is like legislation in our government for human trafficking. So he was on board, and San Diego was on board because it's so prevalent here. So it's so important to know that you guys have really been, if you've been living here, engaged in the work, congratulations if you've been in the work for more than like 5 years, because that is really huge. But in Orange County, it kind of got up there and started talking about these things at the conference, and you know, women's centers were giving us information about human trafficking. And so by the time that I got a hold of human trafficking, the first documentary called Born in the Brothels had really started bringing awareness through the Kids with Cameras and the project they had going on. And I know that film came to this campus. So basically what I'm saying is the organization that started with that video ended up giving 8 girls from Vanguard the rights to promote them. And we started an aftercare home with that project in Sonogachi Red Light in India. And from that experience, that was my junior and senior year. And you know, getting engaged with the work as a college student, you know, you can get all your friends involved, and you can plan as many art shows and get people, you know, to understand the topic just, you know, briefly. But I spent the last 4 or 5 years, you know, continuing this road, and no longer am I working for them, but they're doing a great job and they have the home up. I've, in the last 2 years, been with Tiny Hands International, and they're doing work that I first was exposed to from Kids with Destiny by going to India. So we work in Nepal, and the big problem in Nepal is Nepalese girls are the ones that are being trafficked to India into the brothels and red lights there. And in the oldest and largest brothel that I had ever been to and seen that exists in India, called Sonogachi, they just have hundreds and hundreds of Nepalese girls. And I'm wondering, well, why, you know? So today we're gonna talk about that a little bit, about a little bit more about how that clicked for me is, you know, let's stop these girls from being fed into this system, right? That makes sense, you know, if something's wrong and you're figuring out, you know, the problem, you want to get to the root of it. So that's why I'm with Tiny Hands, and we're working towards stopping that problem. And everyone, this is Doug Dorr. He is the executive director of Tiny Hands. He just flew in today, and we're just loving California. I just want to say thanks so much for Doug, because he came out here. We're going to be going around telling a couple students from Baylor as well about these projects, and we're just really we're really happy to be here. So he'll be handing out some stuff at the end. So I want to ask you guys. I know this is going to get you out of your comfort level, but so some of you that came here just to be in class, you don't have to answer anything. But those that really know about human trafficking, I really want to know. I'm going to just break this down by hearing from you what you think human trafficking is. If you think it's slavery, what kind of slavery, and if you can tell me where you heard about it. So does anyone have an example of how you heard about slavery or human trafficking and what kind it was? I know you guys have heard about this. I don't think anyone in this room has not heard about slavery or human trafficking. Okay, Sex Trade in Cambodia. You guys read a book from a Somali man. That's a really great example of, let's see here. We'll talk about this last one. It says, industries such as labor, services, or sex. Cambodia, unfortunately, is one of the most prevalent sex trade industries. And we're not going to be talking about that today, but it does have an effect on us because we're Nepal, and so we are in East Asia. And the sex slave trade there has a lot to do with just the gender issues in the area and the treatment of women and the poverty that they have, and then in turn, they're working a lot for their families and sending money home. So part of the work that we're doing is to get at-risk girls so that, you know, the poverty line for those that have a childhood that they're not going to, you know, getting education and having job skills training provided for them or anything. They'll oftentimes either their family won't have enough money and they'll be sold as a child because their family is trying to support the rest of their family. Or, there's just a lot of reasons, I guess, that the poverty line will affect trafficking in turn, like at the very end of you know, what a family will do to get money. So a lot of those issues also happen in Cambodia. Is there any other examples of how you guys have seen human trafficking?
Yeah.
Can you talk really loud?
Yeah, sure. I saw a film that IJM did a couple years ago about indentured slavery and sex slavery in India.
Okay. And so one of the things I forgot to mention, after Lindsay came out to DC and she did her internship, I never thought that I would graduate and be out of school for a little while and then be an intern. I actually interned for IJM in DC. That film's called At the End of Slavery, and they show a lot of the brick kilns and the bonded labor. One of the things here says, bonded labor is one of the forms that they were exposing in that video, and part of that is when one family, let's say, has a debt going in, the father has a debt for getting into trafficking. The whole family after that, if he has children on that slave farm, whether it's bricks, whether it's carpets, whether it's a coal mine, the entire family now has that debt, and the entire family is now a slave. And they can't get out of that debt because the slave owner builds upon it, says, you know, you just worked really, you know, slow today, so therefore your whole family has this debt. And it will be impossible to ever pay it off. So, that's another really good example of who's doing work. It's International Justice Mission. Thanks.
Go ahead. I recently read the book Half the Sky.
Okay.
Which does a great job of just outlining different trafficking issues in three different regions of the world, between the Middle East, India, and East Asia. Kind of outlining both like cultural issues and then a lot of just background information of what's really going on. And they also do a really good job of giving a bunch of programs that do a lot of work that are really helping resolve some of these issues.
Okay, yeah. Half the Sky is written by Nicholas Kristof. It came out just a year ago. It's a really recent book. It goes through women's issues, so if you have any interest in that, it's a great resource. I do have to say, though, part of that book that I disagree with, and won't be shy to say, is he does purchase a girl out of slavery and gives her the means to move on with her life. And you might be thinking, why in the world would you not like that? You know, she's out of slavery. Well, that kind of brings me to the point of talking about supply and demand in our business model. One of the things that does not end slavery, in my opinion, and a lot of theorists out there, is to say that if you pay the money that goes to the trafficker, that trafficker will buy another girl with that money. You're paying for slavery. And you may think, oh, I'm paying for this girl's life to be out of slavery, yay. Who are you to think that you know all about slavery and all about the victim that will be replacing her? So basically the model here is globalization has reduced people, and this is the bottom line of what trafficking is. So globalization has reduced people to be sold for profit, right? If we're thinking about any other product, it basically would be the same. Drug trafficking is a good example. You know, drug is a product. Humans are that product. And once you can replace a product, and it can be very disposable, you basically are replacing humans as worthless beings. So some girl dies in a brothel, oh, okay, we'll replace her. So that's one of the things that I want you guys to think critically about, is how to solve this issue but not replace humans into the slave trade. That's a really, really good book. Nicholas Kristof, just tying that back in. It's a really good book, but he does purchase a girl out of slavery, and I would disagree with that. So you can look into it.
So,
like I was saying, I was in the Santa Cachi red light, and this is one of the girls that would have been prevented from going to into slavery. We don't actually know with our work in Nepal, we don't actually, is this too loud? I'm just going to put it down.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys. We don't actually know if this girl would have gone into sex slavery, but the whole idea is we know the factors that they're told, you know, you're here, you're going to go abroad for a good job. That could be a possibility. That's a red flag for us if we're questioning at the border. The girls are also told that they can be sold into, or they're not told they're going to be sold, but they can be persuaded into a marriage. And those are two main factors of why we question the girls at the border, and we ask them, you know, why are you going to India? And it's a lot of false pretenses that they're told, and then once they get over there is when they're trafficked. And it's very likely that once we get down to the bottom of it and we actually ask those questions, that those are reasons they don't know the actual answers, they were just going to go across the border. And so this girl was stopped at the age of 17 through the ministry we have. And I want to show you guys I'm going to stop talking and show you a video. It's a 12-minute clip, and I'd really encourage all of you to stay and watch it and write questions down, because right after we're going to ask questions. It pretty much talks about, go ahead and go to the next slide. It's going to talk about the organization from start to finish, so you can watch it.
Girls in Nepal face many difficulties. Gender prejudice is reinforced by dowry and caste systems that leave many poor girls with few options. Every year, thousands of these girls leave their villages to come to Kathmandu to look for work, hoping to send back enough money for their little brothers and sisters to go to school. When they arrive, they find few opportunities except the Kathmandu sex industry, which is made up of cabin restaurants, massage parlors, and dance restaurants. Girls in this industry start out as simple workers, but are eventually forced to perform sexual favors for customers. Out of these businesses, and directly from the villages of Nepal, traffickers recruit young and trusting Nepali girls, offering them false jobs in India or false marriages. They cross the little towns on the border, hardly even noticed by anyone. When they arrive, they are sold into brothels. There are 26 official crossings in the Nepal-India border. It is an open border, and Nepali and Indian people are not stopped or required to show passports. While police are working, they seldom stop suspected trafficking cases. Even if they do, they are not risky bribeable. Jungle-like paths, white river plains, and rickety bridges form the landscape. The difficulty of the terrain and the lack of transportation routes makes it difficult for traffickers to cross away from the major crossings without arousing suspicion. And the chaos of the major border crossings make them the easiest chance for traffickers to slip past unnoticed. In one border town, one pastor and his church are doing their part to fight trafficking. This pastor had been praying for a way to stop trafficking for many years when he was approached by tiny hands to start working against trafficking in May 2009. He formed a subcommittee made up of local Christians. This subcommittee oversees a tiny hands border monitoring station. They employ several border guards who monitor key border crossings nearby, stopping suspected traffickers and questioning them in order to find real trafficking cases. Tiny Hands oversees more than 10 of the border monitoring stations at important points all along the 1100-mile Nepal-India border. Each station is overseen by a subcommittee made up of local Christians. These stations employ more than 35 border guards who watch busy crossings from morning till night, 7 days a week, looking for signs of trafficking. In some cases, they monitor busy train stations with trains departing from major cities in the body of India. These stations swarm with activity just before a departure. It is easy for traffickers to hide amongst the crowd. Tiny Hands staff walk the crowd, looking for young girls bearing certain signs. For Delhi, leaving the locals to sweep up its trash and Tiny Hand staff to prepare for the next arrival. In some places, small wooden bridges form the only path across the border rivers. Tiny Hand staff watch and wait in the hot sun. At one station, two nicely dressed girls at just the right age approach the border and walk right by a policeman. He does not even turn his head. Iranian staff closer to the border spot the girls and stop them for questioning. The girls say that they are going to India to repair their mobile phone. The border guards separate the girls, questioning them individually for several minutes. One of the girls produces a broken phone with a bill from a shop in India. Their story checks out. After a few minutes, the girls are allowed to continue on their way. At another Tiny Hands border monitoring station, two girls attempting to cross the border are brought to our booth for an investigation. They say that they had run away from home to find work in Darjeeling, which they mistakenly thought was in Nepal. They have never heard of human trafficking. Tiny Hands staff contact their relatives, who say there had been a boy with them, but there is no sign of the boy, and the girls will not say more. The relatives instruct the staff not to let them cross the border, saying that they would come right away. A brother of one of the girls rides an all-night bus to pick up the girls and take them safely home. Two more girls are stopped the same day and brought to the booth for questioning. They give suspicious and contradictory answers to questions from Tiny Head staff, and they are brought to a nearby safe house. The girls agree to a taped interview. It's not clear at first why the girls were going to India. They are newly married. At first, they say they were married a few months ago. Then later, they say it was just a few days before. This is an important red flag for the staff. Traffickers will often use fake marriages to convince girls to come to India, then abandon them in a brothel. The girls also contradict themselves and each other about whether they are sisters, where they met their husbands, and why they are going to India. It is clear that someone has tried to coach them in what to say. They have never heard of human trafficking. Eventually, Tiny and staff are able to get a hold of the girl's mother. The mother pleads with the border staff not to let the girls cross into India. She says she will come to get them herself. While the girls are waiting in the safe house, one of the girls gets a phone call. It is her new husband, the suspected trafficker. He says he's coming to get her. She's excited, but Tiny Hands staff do not publicly disclose the location of the safe house, and the trafficker does not know where it is. He comes with his older brother to the booth to argue with Tiny Hands staff. An older woman is with them, claiming she's like a sister to the two girls. The brother says he has already talked to the girl's mom, who said to let the girls go with them to India. Tiny Hand staff calls the mom for a second time, and the mother frantically begs the staff not to let the girls go with these people, saying that she is coming herself to take the girls with her back to her village. Back at the shelter, the girl is safe with Tiny Hand staff. For two nights, the girls stay at the shelter, until one girl's mother and the other girl's brother come to the border to pick them up and escort them to the safety of their home. These four girls were intercepted by Tiny Hands staff and prevented from being trafficked. They agreed to let us tell their stories in a video to be shown in the United States to raise money and awareness for this work. That month, at several points along the Nepal-India border, Tiny Hands intercepted 135 girls in similar circumstances and prevented them from being trafficked. These girls' stories are typical. Since May of 2009, Tiny Hands border staff have intercepted more than 100 girls per month, spending an average of $2,000 per month. Just $20 to intercept one girl and prevent her from being trafficked. Working through JERT subcommittees provides us with a committed, capable, well-connected community of dedicated management who work tirelessly without pay to prevent trafficking. Motivated only by their love for God and innocent victims they have never met. The subcommittee members voluntarily give dozens of hours every week to this work. They work under constant pressure from corrupt police officials and powerful traffickers. They are frequently harassed, and their lives are threatened. But they are stirring up a revival in prayer and active love among local community Christians. In this church, one of the churches involved in the subcommittee, local believers gather every single day to pray for this work. They are fighting persecution with prayer, and God is answering. Not one tiny hand staff or subcommittee has been harmed in the line of duty. Back in the United States, a prayer movement is hoping to provide prayer covering and financial support for this work. One Girl is a program in which supporters purchase one girl bracelets and give their commitment to pray for the interception of one girl along with their bracelets. These bracelets are made by women in a tiny hands home in Kathmandu, created for women who have been victims of the Kathmandu sex industry. At the time of this filming, just over 1,000 people have purchased one girl bracelets and committed to praying for one girl to be saved from trafficking. God is answering their prayers. During the same period, just over 1,000 girls have been intercepted by tiny hand staff. For each one girl bracelet sold during this period, tiny hands has intercepted one girl.
The daughter, and at that point we will question them more thoroughly. Sometimes subcommittees do take action going back and finding out themselves whether that community is a safe place for them. So we will not send them back unless they are in a safe place and they will not get re-trafficked. Okay. We're going to have more time for their question and answer, but I did want to get to this slide. 246 million children between 5 and 17 years are working instead of attending school. Earlier, I briefly mentioned how education is very, very important for young girls. The poverty line is also, important for families to not go underneath and to rise above. And so in doing that, we want children to be in school. It's a right that every child has. And to be able to go to school, that child gains the right education, skills, or any skills to better their lives for themselves. But we can all agree on that. It's a big problem that children are not going to school and they're working. And a lot of the time, what I said with bonded labor, children are born into slavery. So that could be a rite of passage for them. It's just not getting education and just being slaves. So it's a big problem. 23.2 million people live in Nepal, and 80% of those people only earn less than $2 a day. That has a huge effect on why girls are trafficked. There's 10,000 girls that get trafficked to Nepal every year. And that number is actually, to connect it to home, there's 10,000 slaves in the United States at any given time. There's 14 to 17,000 that get trafficked. So not necessarily that looks like, you know, very obvious, like, in the old days, it's cotton farms, but it could be migrant work, it could be domestic servitude here. That number doesn't compare with the size of Nepal. And in India, actually, Nepal it's tiny, and to know that 10,000 girls are actually going into Nepal, there's actually, in Sonaganchi, the red light that I was in, there's 10,000 girls that are, that number is just popping up everywhere, but there are 10,000 women at any time standing in line. And those women, each of them, service about 30 men a day. So knowing that the girls from Nepal either go to Mumbai, these major districts, and it's just astronomical how those numbers connect, like 10,000 here in the United States, 10,000 Nepali girls going over, 10,000 at just one red light district in Nepal, in India. So you may be thinking, wow, thanks for that. Part of what we do is definitely pray, and we definitely have a biblical mandate. I actually ran into Gary Havney quite a bit while at an intern at International Justice Mission. And let me just side note, sorry Doug, I'm talking about IJM. I really do like them. Their work is great. And as an intern for them, you learn the basics of a biblical mandate. And so this is actually from them, and I just want to say that straight out. They use this in their slides, and if you go to another presentation, they'll also tell you. But IJM taught me that for the first time, there's just no way that you can prosecute a pimp and you can get numbers the way that they're getting in rescuing girls from out of brothels, or prosecuting illegal property seizures or things that are unrightfully done, the greatest injustices of the world. And we at Tiny Hands think that, part of the work we do, it's because slave trafficking and these girls leaving Nepal is one of the greatest injustices we see. And that's probably because we've seen it, and probably because we're working, knee deep in it, but you guys have all seen great injustices. And to get through those things, you definitely need a biblical mandate to know why you rescue in the first place. And I believe that God does call us to this work. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, and to love mercy, and walk humbly with your God, Micah 6:8. It says clearly in Isaiah 1:17, seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, and plead for the widow. These are things in scripture that are called out to do them, and to seek the justice from the injustice, the greatest things that you find injustice in. And it's been retold over and over again in the Bible. Different characters, Moses, Joseph, Ruth, Esther, all of them were to bring rescue to a people, a time of slavery that's historic in the Bible. And God called those people and used them. And we can't do this work unless people are called to it. God has seen those children. He sees them in the brothels. And you know what? He's calling people to intercept. And that's the truth of the matter. And I definitely believe prayer is a part of that as well. But I think that if we just talk and talk and talk, nothing's going to be done. Is that right? Okay, so part of our work, I just want to hone in on this again. So who's doing the work? One of the things we're doing in Nepal is to fight the greatest injustices. We actually started as children's homes, and now we're fighting trafficking. So God does things for the organizations and calls them to the work. Is that right? We had originally in 2004 started opening up children's homes, and that was our mission. We felt called to go in and rescue the orphan, right? We realized those orphans, those girls are at risk. Why not stop them and put them in a home and take them from, you know, a situation where they could be trafficked? So becoming from homes became a ministry of trafficking prevention. And so we started working with prevention on the borders in 2009 after starting to kind of dabble in trafficking and understanding the issues. The border stations, what you saw before, has been a very, very big project. There's about 11 to 14. And so you saw a lot about that. I won't repeat myself. There's also a women's empowerment program. A lot of you guys might be social workers or invested in, you know, job skills training for those that are trying to make something of their lives, and that's basically what we're doing. We're there, you know, there's opportunities like microfinance, and hopefully we'll do like micro loans for education, but we're not there yet. And then, you know, there's we're doing the jewelry and the bracelets. And then we're just now, what I'm trying to get to is all the excitement. We're actually going to show you a couple more videos, and I want you to see this timeline and point out these dates, because you can see clearly how God has changed and transformed the ministry once we've opened our eyes to the need around us. And I know that San Diego has the same need in your community. And you can start in one project, and it, you know, how God calls you, you know, can really be revealed. So it was children's homes, human trafficking and products to help girls, you know, rehabilitation, basically. And then we stopped them from going down. Now we're trying to increase our women's empowerment, and we're bringing on investigations just like, you know, this year. We really want prosecutions to happen, and unfortunately, in the beginning of our work, we weren't doing that, but, you know, you can evaluate any nonprofit and say, let's hope for that, and that's what's happening right now, so it's great. And now police training. So police training investigations are our newest thing, and I want to go ahead and show you a video clip of where we were about a year ago, and then show you where we are today. Oh, sorry. Anyone know where Nepal is? Right there. The video showed a little clip of like our border station, so that's good. I'm kind of going off my notes. Let me get back here. Go ahead and go to the video. Okay. So let me just preface this video by saying this is the guy in Nepal. We have one expat. Back there, and we have about 100 new police working for us at the stations, or we've just hired, like, we work with the local church, so we're not hiring everyone that works for us. We're really expanding our network. But he has been there, and he's been starting all of our projects, so let's hear from him about what was going on a year ago.
Beckoning, you know, to passers by. They look like they're willing. It doesn't look like these are girls who are forced into it. It looks like they're willing. So again, it doesn't look like a horrible injustice. The truth of what happens to them is that young girls are deceived and by false marriages and false offers of employment into going to India, and under false pretenses, when they get there, they're abandoned into a brothel where they're literally slaves. And they're not allowed to leave the brothel, and in some cases they're not allowed to talk to anyone, they're not allowed to contact anyone, and they're tortured and beaten and gang raped in order to be initiated into that life. So, but no one sees that because that's so invisible to the population. So as a result, there's just a widespread perception of the fact that trafficking is not a particularly horrible thing. It's not seen as a really bad thing. And so because of that, police and other officials, there's not much political or legal opposition to trafficking. So the border of Nepal is 1,500, 1,800 kilometers.
Okay, so if you go to the next slide, it's a picture of
what we're going to see. I have John Molino here, and we're tiny.
This is what the booth looks like in all of the stations we have so far. It does say our name on it, and you're probably wondering, is that safe, you know? Actually, having an NGO there puts pressure on the police. And though at first, a year ago, kind of in the midst of this project for 1,200 rescues, we're now close to 3,000, it really was difficult to partner with the police, but once we were present, meaning our name, people, a booth, they knew who we were. They knew what we were doing. They knew we were there. And so, therefore, you know, if they had any questions, if they were interested, at least they were coming to us. And putting that pressure there was wonderful in stopping the flow. It's obvious that we're there, and the community knows, kind of, if they come up to the booth, you know, we will tell them what we're doing, and it's not as dangerous as you think. So, yeah. Go ahead and go to the next. I just wanted to show another clip. The reason why I want to show you these is because it was a really difficult effort. When you go into a project, let's say you're starting a new project, you see all these obstacles, and we saw police corruption, right? That was one of the biggest things we saw. And we said, okay, well, we'll tackle this, God willing, and see what happens. And a year ago, it was frustrating. We had been doing this journey for a couple months, and it was still a big issue, and it still is today. It's not as bad with the ones that we work with. And so it is really important to see this process, because if any of you start projects, you need to pray harder for the things that come up that are difficult. So go ahead and play this video.
Though having police working with us and standing behind us is crucial to effectively monitor the border, at the same time, police corruption is just the thing that allows trafficking to occur in the first place. One, and two, which it caused all the traffickers that we're able to stop to be disciplined. So many times we'll stop a case of trafficking, and that trafficker will be brought to the police station for investigation, but so far, 100% of the cases that we've stopped, and that's about 1,200 in the last 10 months, the trafficker is simply this. This police corruption is really what allows it to go on, it's a really difficult problem. We need to stop it. If we want to build a stop, we also need traffic and have traffickers apprehended.
Thank you. So there's 27 million slaves in the world today. And we're just brushing upon a small, small issue. But we don't want to forget where they go, and that's a reminder. We may see them as girls that aren't trafficked, and that's fortunate, right? But this is where they go, and this is where they live, where they service men in their tiny little bodies. And they don't get out. There's dark rooms, there's no windows. And can you just imagine the depravity of what they don't even know going across the border? They don't even know what could happen. And I'm not saying every girl goes to slavery and sex slavery, but the ones that do are the most unfortunate, and it is the greatest injustice, I believe. So, like I said again, we are called, and I'm actually not completely concluding, but if you have to go, I understand I'm getting a little bit long on my presentation, but the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of the sight to the blind, to release the oppressed, He's called each and every one of us, and I know that everyone has a different passion and different call, but I think in the case of 27 million slaves, your attention to one is worth your time, is it not? So it's very, very important to think of what is happening in that room every day, and we're just so fortunate here to be praying on the other side, but knowing that God does see that girl and does see that child and those that are enslaved in that life. Okay, on a hopeful note, everyone, I'm going to introduce you to Jeff Blum. Jeff Blum and I met, I was an intern at IJM, and he is the Vice President of Investigations, former. As of January of this year, God really, really worked in the ministry of Tiny Hands, and this is where we're going to go. He's on his way with Doug at the end of this month on March 23rd to go to Nepal and start an entire new investigations project where we're going to start prosecuting and looking into training the police more effectively. And he just stepped down from IJM in January, and at that same time, sorry to go into details, but my husband and I went to lunch with him the day that he announced he was resigning from IJM. Somehow Tiny Hands came up, and he felt very, very passionate to bring his expertise to the work. So I want you to hear about his experience, and this gives you a glimpse of who to look for in helping your projects develop.
I'm here to welcome former Vice President of Investigations at International Justice Mission, Jeff Blum, to the work of Tiny Hands International. Jeff, how did you hear about us and what attracts you to our work?
I first heard about Tiny Hands International after meeting with Jen, talking with her during lunch one day, and she told me about this small organization, Tiny Hands International, how they're trying to stop the flow of Nepali girls into India and their brothels there. And I immediately became interested because I had been in Sanagachi, a red light area in Kolkata, India, where a lot of these Nepali girls end up. I've personally been into this area hundreds of times conducting undercover investigations and actually been in some of these Nepali brothels and seeing these girls up close and personal, their lifeless, expressionless faces. Looking into their eyes, I can see the pain and suffering that they were enduring and the looks of helplessness. And right then and there, I knew I needed to do something to help stop the flow of these girls coming into India. But then I didn't know what I could do. And since leaving International Justice Mission, I've teamed up with Tiny Hands International, and hopefully going up there and helping set up investigations to help stop the flow of these girls into India. Most of the large agencies, and even 5 years as a chief of police. I've been in assignments of a SWAT team, undercover narcotics, intelligence, investigations, administrative assignments throughout my career. I've been with another anti-trafficking organization for over 4.5 years, 3 years as a head of investigations, overseeing all types of investigations and a police training program there. I have over 10 years of experience as a professional police trainer, as a post-generalist instructor, combat firearms, defensive tactics, and I've taught numerous other courses throughout my career. I've trained police agencies in 5 different countries with IJM, as well as conducted an 80-hour basic investigator course I put on last year in 3 different regions. I plan on bringing this experience and expertise to work with Tiny Hands International to be able to achieve the goal of working with the Nepali police and hopefully getting them to help curb the trafficking of Nepali girls.
Way that God would tell me to go and do the work that Jeff's doing, right?
So I definitely want to encourage you to find your passion, what you're good at, and let others do the things that they're trained to do. And that doesn't mean I'm not telling you don't go to India, don't go into a brothel, but I'm just saying use people around you to tell you what not to do and be your voice of reason when you feel very, very passionate to go into these places. It sometimes ruins the work that others are doing, and others have a lot more experience, especially those that are older. So yeah, it's a good checks and balance, and I'm just so excited that Jeff's coming on board. We wouldn't be able to do prosecutions at all without someone like him. So that brings me to this slide, because I skipped it earlier. If you guys know anything about legislation, we have one trafficking office in the Department of State called the Trafficking in Persons Office, and Sita Baca leads that up. And he, on one of the clips that I saw, was kind of explaining more in depth with the report that they put out every year. That report is funded by the Trafficking Victims Protection Act. It's been revised, started in 01, revised 03, 05, 08, and is going to be revised this year, so everyone pay attention to that and tell your senators and congressmen. This is one of the key elements that you guys can translate here into the community of San Diego. I think it translates all the way to Nepal, any project in the world, and for some reason, our Trafficking in Persons report just pinpointed it exactly. These are the four P's. This is what I really agree that is happening in the world of human trafficking: prevention, protection, prosecution, and partnership. In a recent conversation, I was like, yeah, these are great. This is the great model that everyone can use. Everyone, you know, partnership is key. I agree with that. Prosecution, yeah, IJM, I agree with that. There's so many organizations that have specifically honed in on these things, but these, I think, cover it all. So, you know, it would be great if one organization did it all here in San Diego, but that's probably not the case. So, you know, stretching yourself into finding those areas of work would be good for any of you guys. If you're a lawyer, maybe prosecution, partnership, that could go a lot of ways. Prevention and protection is often aftercare. But one of the things in a conversation I had, you want to click, for Christians, it's prayer, of course, the 5th P. That makes sense. And the TIP report missed it, darn. But yeah, so obviously, prayer. And, you know, everyone can do that. And I think that that should be a part of the work. It's a core part of the work, because it'll transform, you know, ultimately, if you look at 27 million slaves, it seems impossible. So for Christians in the work, it is prayer that is part of the fifth key. So with that being said, I'm actually going to just conclude. I actually want to ask questions initially about the topic, and then I'm going to have Jamie come up after that. Does anyone have questions about this or the other videos we showed? Yeah?
I think the movie talked about when the ladies come back to Nepal, they're ostracized from their communities or from their families. Is there any way that, I don't know the situations of how the families are structured in Nepal, but is there any way to bring those females back in? Is there restoration of the family unit? Mm-hmm. Or is there any way to possibly do that?
Yeah, he's asking, is there restoration for the family? The girl comes back and let's say, for example, she was sold by her family. Let's say that. Well, one answer is, do we do that work? I guess we have subcommittees that investigate the work, but we don't have the funding to follow up and stay for too long. We will not leave the girl with the family if it's going to be a case of re-trafficking, which is a big problem. What would you say, Doug? That's a pretty good answer for our work, but I don't know of a lot of organizations that spend time reintegrating a girl with a family, which sounds like a really great case, but in the end, you never really know. It might just be protecting a girl that's at risk for re-trafficking. Maybe if you leave her there after the family agrees to, you know, be great to her, she could just get re-trafficked within the year. So.
And even if the girl happens to be raped on the way to the border, same situation. Basically, can't go back to her village because she's ostracized. And so that is a very difficult thing to try to bridge. And right now, you're combating and competing against culture. And mm-hmm. years and years and years yeah. of culture. And the whole idea of karma and the whole idea of caste system all plays into it. So it's, right now, I'd say it's very difficult.
Yeah, and off the topic of Nepal, but India, some experiences there. I was talking to Jeff. We both had been in the same red light district, and we both are called to this work because we had seen the girls, the Nepali girls there. And one of the things that he said was just, you know, mind-blowing, because he said that there were girls in, do you guys know the Taj Mahal, Agra and the Taj Mahal? Girls there spiritually are entrapped into prostitution as part of culture. They're called like Agra prostitutes, there's a word for it in Bengali. But Jeff was saying how he would ask the girl, you know, do you want to come out? He was doing all these undercover things with IJM, and and the girls just said, this is my rite of passage. This is what I know to do. None of my family would take me back. There's no place for me to go. This is my life. And those are the kind of girls in the culture, when you're talking about culture ingrained, there's no convincing that girl to leave, even if you could pull her out. Some of these things are so ingrained in the culture, ostracizing, things like that. And it's here today. What do we think of prostitution? What do we think of a rape? We know that, you know, if some gossip comes out and someone had a horrific, traumatic experience, are we the first to comfort? You know, so it's our culture too, you know?
Yeah, one thing too, I just want to just like that real quick.
Yeah.
Nepal is the fastest growing church in the world today. So there's the hope. The hope is that the church, the body of Christ, will change the attitude of the culture, and which will allow integration back to the families. I think, you know, that's years down the road.
Yeah, and our subcommittees are made up of the church. We're not going and hiring all these people to do this work. This local church is empowering us to do the work and help them. So, yeah, that's a great question, Ace. Are you guys interested? Is this, like, good? I want questions. I want interaction.
I just have a question. Did you just say that Nepal has the fastest growing Christian church in the world?
It's also it's like a first generation church too, so it's real young, real immature, and the culture still impacts the church to a large extent, but every year it's starting to, you know, change, and we're starting to find people that we can employ that are going to be really effective long term. So it's really exciting. Now's the time to do the work, and so we're really trying to get involved in it.
Okay, I'm
going to
take one question and have Jamie come up.
How do you guys deal with coercion and when you're doing border interceptions? Because a lot of people, they're coming from desperate situations, and they're convinced that this is their hope.
Yeah.
And that's all they can see. How do you prevent a girl from leaving, even when you foresee what conditions are happening, where she's convinced that this is her only chance for her hope?
Right. Haley's asking about coercion and basically, how do we address coercion in the girl's belief that she's going to have a hopeful and prosperous life from what she's told? From the video, you saw that we question and we interact with the girls and we sit them down and we ask questions. Are you, what are you told? And tell us more about it. And if they don't know their future, it's very, very likely it's going to be trafficking. And we don't want to necessarily crush their hopes, but we reveal what trafficking is. And if they don't know what it is, they have their choice of what they want to believe. And I think without that choice at all, you can see how that could go down that road. But let's say they do know about trafficking, and they still believe that this is the choice for them. Do you know if we would, typically let that go? I think they're really good at the border. I mean, I'm not the one doing the actual questioning. I'm not speaking Nepali, but...
They separate the girls and the traffickers, and they'll even separate if there's multiple girls that are being trafficked. They'll separate them all, ask them the same questions, and if they don't get the same answers, then it's obvious that they're being trafficked.
And sometimes it doesn't look like a trafficker is actually with the girl. Sometimes the girl goes a couple yards ahead, and the trafficker is also walking. And you saw in the video, it's just chaos, right? That's a border. It doesn't look like, there's a bamboo stick that's the crossing. So it can get really chaotic, but essentially sometimes the trafficker is there, sometimes they're not, and depending on if they're there or not, it affects the girl and her answers. But the more time we investigate and question is when the truth hopefully is revealed. So I'll go ahead and have Jamie come up for a sec, and we will dive more into questions, but we'll take a period of time that you can leave if you need to.
So I'm curious. This connects to to us here at Point Home at lots of different levels. And sort of a common question is always, you know, how do we begin to even get involved in this? And you touched on this just briefly, Jenna. So I'm learning more and more about human trafficking. My heart's heavier and heavier, and I'm a passionate young person, and I want to do something like soon. So do I go start a nonprofit? Do I go take, you know, six of my friends from Point Loma and go plant myself in India, Nepal, in Uganda, and, you know, in maybe right here in San Diego, start investigating, you know, what's happening in the brothels? And is that the way to go about this?
Yeah. Well, that's a lot of questions. Hopefully you guys come with questions after the presentation, specifically for me, for like how you can get involved and what you're interested in. But overall, I really believe in checks and balance, and I believe that if you are with an organization and someone can tell you no, don't do something, that's the organization that, you know, you should be a part of something instead of on your own, is what I'm going to say. And I don't believe with all of our passion in college that we can do everything. I just don't. And I'm so sorry to crush dreams, but if someone can tell you no and you hate that answer, it's probably best for the work of trafficking. There's so much to know and there's so much to learn, and I'm still learning what I can't do. He tells me all the time I can't do, no, I'm just kidding. But yeah, so.
This is not exactly safe work we're necessarily talking about, and that's not a necessary term. But it's also not simple. There are layers and layers to the relationships that are involved, to the systems of law that are involved, the enforcement or lack of enforcement that are involved, the various relationships between organizations and churches, between nonprofits or what in your world is NGOs, right? And churches, and the complexity of this is just mind-boggling. Mm-hmm. And I know that you all live in this complexity, and just beginning to, some of us in this room are just stepping into that complexity for the first time. Some of us have been wading in a little deeper, and it's getting a little overwhelming. I wanna encourage us all to. There are very tangible and practical steps. I mean, you all have bracelets that you're selling tonight. That's a very practical step. I encourage anyone here to consider supporting them, buying a bracelet. But sort of developing wisdom to add to the passion that is growing around this issue. That's sort of where we're at as a university.
Right.
I really want to encourage you. If tonight or before tonight, some of these issues, this particular complexity of issues tugs at your heart, come 6 o'clock Wednesday nights. Join the Beauty for Ashes group because they're about discernment. They're about, like, what shall we do together? How do we bring our different gifts, as you were saying tonight, together, right? I've been meeting with FBI, Sheriff's Department. I've been meeting with ICE, the law enforcement folks. There's a task force in town on human trafficking that's just now starting to connect with the academy, to the universities, and starting to get it. And they're asking, you know, I'm telling them there's probably a much larger sort of pent up energy on our campus for getting engaged. And people are coming to me and to Haley and some others and saying, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? And there's not a lot that you can kind of go do in San Diego with the traffic victims in mass, right? Because it's a delicate subject and it's a complex issue, and there's difficult conversations to be had. And so we're trying to gather that wisdom, and we need you to be a part of that wisdom gathering. Haley, do you want to
chime in? Just speaking as somebody, I know that there's plenty of you that know about this and have been concerned about this for a while, but just speaking out from my own place, being somebody who I want to go, my desire is to go and to be part of it and to do something tangible. I think that a fear that I have, and I think I recognize from a lot of people our age, is that we're afraid that when we're done with all this, that all this education, that we'll come to a place and, it was for nothing. I mean, that even though we try and we dream of all these things, that in the end we will make a difference. And I encountered dealing with the answer of no. I had the opportunity to go to China and work with people, girls who had been and they were transitioning out of trafficking, and right at the last minute, that opportunity ended, and I didn't get the chance to go, and I didn't get the chance to be part of it and see it, encounter it firsthand, and I felt really bitter about it.
because I felt like I have a heart, Lord, and I want to be part of this. But in Zephaniah it says, do not despise these small beginnings. And I think so many times when we depreciate the value of being faithful in the lives that we lead here, and being patient for the Lord's timing and discernment in our lives, and having the courage to step up and to do things that are overwhelming when the opportunity presents, but also having the patience to wait on the Lord's timing and to pursue ways to be active where you are. And it's not complacency. And I think sometimes you can lose steam real easily. If you get all this passion and you learn about an issue, you're like, let's do something, and it doesn't look the way you thought it would, I think that's the biggest challenge, is that the Lord's work does not necessarily look the way we think it's going to look. And appreciating the fact that dedicating faithfulness, and the Lord honors like faithfulness to this issue. So if you don't get to see the action, or you don't get to be part of the adventure of like saving the day and the rescue, like hang in there and wait for the Lord to open opportunities, because the Lord is about redemption. And so there are opportunities.
It's the opposite side of the complexity, right? This is a very complex issue, but that means that there's a tremendous number of opportunities, mm-hmm. multiple levels to begin to engage. If you're interested in housing, if you're interested in law, if you're interested in social work, if you're interested in medicine, if you're interested in, you know, the teaching biology, there's a place to plug in, as complex as this particular issue is. The question is, how are you directing your energies, right? So you're gonna be a nursing major. Have you ever thought about using your nursing major to care for the victims of trafficking on one side of the ocean or another? You know, if you're going to be a political science major, have you thought about, you know, investigating the trafficking legislation and the enforcement behind the trafficking legislation, right? A criminal justice major, maybe the enforcement work that you go into. And from what I hear from all the folks in the San Diego region alone, recently just found out that since 2005, we have almost 400 cases of human trafficking in San Diego. It's very local issue, right?
Yeah, and talking to locals, and having been in D.C. and having issues from represent the whole country, you can tell San Diego already, just being here, the depth of what you guys are going through is huge. So there's a lot to do in San Diego, for sure. What's the time?
We're close
okay.
to...
Okay, so I personally want to engage a little bit more. So you guys, if it's okay, if you need to leave,
We'll finish officially at 8:30. If those of you that need to leave, feel free at any time.
This is a good exit, and I know you guys have busy stuff.